Yeah.
Hi guys, welcome to my defense. Bienvenidos a mi defensa.
Okay.
ready? Okay, welcome to Combat Commandos Certification Defense. So you've been with us for about 5 years. She's from Ecuador. I grew up in Chile. So I was lucky that she chose my lab to do her work. And when she came, we were thinking about processes of wastewater treatment, and the idea that we could run these plants with very low oxygen. We had this stuff right after in the lab. Spent a few months trying to figure out. I was just starting to work. That's my comic name. And then she took over the analysis of that reactor, and essentially through her dissertation, she laid out the fundamentals of why this reactor actually works. And we have been moving her model, her lab scale model, to a pilot system, to operate a pilot system of this water treatment plant. If we work through under the same conditions that Mamet was using, we move to other things and we continue the research, thanks to the things that Pamela discovered during her studies. Her brilliant proposal she wrote a couple of years ago, describing the last set of experiments she was going to do. We actually submitted that to NSF, and we just heard a couple of weeks ago that it has been funded. So, great job on that. And thank you for leaving us with extra funding.
Thank you for the introduction, Ben. Thanks to everyone for attending your presentation today, and hope you enjoy it. So just to start this presentation, I would like to talk a little bit about my professional background, so you get to know me a little bit better. So as Dan said, I was born in Ecuador. But my family moved to Chile when I was about 10 years old. And when I was in Chile in 2011, I received my bachelor's in biology engineering at the University of Santiago in Chile. And here's where I had my first contact with the microbiology field. And I was studying adaptation to oxidative stress of bacteria that are involved in overbiology. So that actually inspired me to keep learning about how we use microorganisms for biotechnological processes. And in 2013, I came to this university to pursue a doctoral degree in civil and environmental engineering. And in 2015, I received my master's in the same program for my studies of cardiac community microbial studies and its role in microbial nutrition. And today, as Dan said, it's a big day where I get to present my thesis. So what you want to see here for the next 45 minutes, I think, it's a summary of the main findings of my research during the last 5 years. And the title of this presentation is Unraveling the Microbial Response to Microbial Conditions in Biological Nutrient Removals or BNRC Ecosystems. And it sounds very complicated, so I'm going to start slowly introducing you to the field, and I hope to cover some of the basic concepts of my research. So, why do we care about microorganisms? Why do we care about these microbial communities? So, these microorganisms inhabit our entire planet, and they have a crucial role not only in biogeochemical processes that occur in nature, but they also contribute to engineering processes. The design of functional microbial communities is to produce a product or carry out a process is becoming a most common approach in fields such as the agricultural one, food production, medicine, energy, and water. So today let's focus on the last one, at the water field, because here we use microorganisms to remove nutrients from wastewater before we try to get a process known as wastewater treatment. And the reason why we remove the nutrients from the wastewater before we release it, it's because if we don't do it and we release all these nutrients into the ecosystem, we're going to cause this over-fertilization of water bodies. These algae that we receive in our lakes are product of the excess of these nutrients, which ends up damaging the environment. So we don't want these in our lakes or in any water body. So today, my presentation is going to be structured like this. I'm going to start by with an overview of the wastewater treatment field, and I'm going to introduce you to the biological removal process, or BNR. Then I'm going to talk about the role of microorganisms in this process and why we care about studying the adaptation of these microorganisms to microbial conditions. Then I'm going to talk about the main findings of my research, and I'm going to focus on two functional groups. One of them is common mouse, and the other one is Acinetobacter phosphatus. And I'll finish this presentation with the main conclusions of my research and some insights in our future directions of the. So all of this water that leaves your houses, that leaves the industries and the hospitals, are going to end up here in the wastewater treatment plant. Here, first, solids are separated from the wastewater in the headworks and primary clarifiers, and then there's a very important process, which is a biological process, where microorganisms that are present here use the nutrients that are present in the wastewater as an energy source. And as engineers, we have taken advantage of the metabolic potential of these microorganisms to design processes where we remove nutrients from the wastewater. However, treatment of wastewater is not an inexpensive process. Actually, wastewater treatment systems are considered significant energy consumers and corresponding to 0.8% of the electrical to the total U.S. electricity consumption. And that number doesn't sound very high, but actually this is the same amount of energy that we can use to power 2 million homes. So this process actually requires a lot of energy from the country. And as engineers, we have tried to optimize different areas in the wastewater treatment plant. For example, we tried to optimize primary and solids treatment. We have even tried to recover energy from the compounds that are present in the wastewater and to improve this biological treatment that is present here. And I'm going to focus today on this biological treatment because here, aeration is the largest energy consuming process, which can account for about 50% of the energy used. So this is a very energy intensive process. So let's take a closer look to this biological process, which is known as biological nutrient removal, or BNR. And what you're seeing here is an example of a configuration of the biological process, which is used to remove nutrients such as carbon, nitrogen, and phosphorus. This process, as you see here, comprises different stages, and in each of these stages, we have a different environmental condition. For example, absence or presence of oxygen or other compounds. So each of these conditions is going to trigger a different biochemical process in the microbial community, which is going to promote removal of these nutrients from the wastewater. For example, the way that phosphorus and carbon are removed from the wastewater starts in the anaerobic zone, where microorganisms are going to release some phosphorus into the public. And I know it sounds contradictory that we want to remove phosphorus, but we are releasing phosphorus to the system. Well, during the anoxic and the aerobic stage, these microorganisms start taking back that phosphorus, and they can take more than what they previously released. So that way, we're more hopefully phosphorus from the wastewater, and we transfer the phosphorus from the wastewater inside the cells of these microorganisms. At the end of the process, in the secondary clarifier here, we separate the cells from the wastewater, and those cells are removed from the system, or part of them are recycled, and the cells that are removed can be used, for example, for biosolids production. In the case of nitrogen, this is mainly present as an inorganic form of ammonia, and this ammonia in the aerobic zone here is oxidized to nitrite and nitrate, and then part of the nitrate is recycled the anoxic zone, and that nitrate is reduced, or also known as reduced nitrogen gas and nitrous oxide, and this is a process called acidification. So those gases are going to leave the plant and go to the atmosphere. So we end up with an effluent that has very, very low concentrations of ammonia, but still has some nitrate, which sometimes can be still being harmed. So overall, in this aerobic zone, you can see here that there are many processes that are being carried out by these microorganisms, and the reason why we pump so much oxygen here is to ensure that the microbes have enough oxygen for both nitrogen and phosphorus removal. However, as I said, that's a very expensive process, and in the current economic environment, reducing the oxygen that these microbial communities require for nutrient removal offers an opportunity for energy and financial savings. It's becoming of great interest for wastewater treatment facilities to explore and develop novel processes for efficient removal of nutrients under low oxygen concentrations. So, as I said, each of these stages is going to trigger the activity of microorganisms. So let's take a closer look to those microbial community. So the microbes in general are the same in all these stages, but what is changing is the activity. We are changing environmental conditions and the microbes are doing something different every time. For example, during the anaerobic stage, when there's no oxygen in the system, we have these glycogen accumulating organisms or polyphosphate accumulating organisms taking care of carbon and releasing phosphorus into the plant. Then the same microorganisms, once we change the conditions and once the nitrite and nitrate present in the system, these microbes are going to change their metabolism and are going to start identifying these nitrite nutrients. And then in the aerobic stage, we have some other microbes, including the ones that we have TB4 to be active to, doing a different process, for example, phosphorus uptake, carbon oxidation, ammonia oxidation, and nitrite oxidation. So now we have been able to identify some of the main functional groups that are present in the wastewater treatment system. There are a lot of studies about the function of these microorganisms. However, we don't know much about how they will respond to low concentrations of phosphate. Therefore, the main goal of this project initially was to develop a biological nutrient removal process that requires lower concentrations of oxygen than the wastewater treatment plant, and to characterize how the microbiome, which means the microbial community living here, can adapt to these microaerobic conditions. In order to achieve this goal, I propose an approach that involves reactive engineering, high throughput sequencing, and multi-omics use. And this approach starts by setting up lab-scale reactors, and in this case, specifically, we set up a reactor that was inoculated with biomass from the local wastewater treatment plant here in Madison, Nine Springs. And our hypothesis was that the microbial community of Nine Springs was going to be able to adapt to microaerobic conditions. And when I say microaerobic, it's for you to have an idea, I mean very low concentrations of oxygen. In fact, this reactor was operated with about 10% of the oxygen that's required in the full-scale treatment. Then we analyzed the microbial community initially using traditional molecular tools such as 16S RNA sequencing, PCR, and microscopy to have an idea of the main members of the microbial community and their function. But then we wanted to look for more information, more detailed information about these microorganisms, and we used some more advanced technologies, advanced approaches like whole genome sequencing and RNA sequencing. These are multi-omics tools, which I'm going to explain in a minute. And we will be using these technologies that rely on sequencing to understand the genomic potential and the gene expression profiles of these microorganisms. And finally, we use the same data for an exploratory analysis of how gene regulation works in these microbes. So we propose that this framework will enhance our understanding of the microbial community and will help predict the response of these microbiomes to different conditions, and with the ultimate goal to inform engineering processes. And as I said, we propose to integrate different omics tools. So for you to understand what omics tools are, I'm going to start by describing the central dogma of molecular biology. This dogma states that DNA has genes that are added in the DNA are first transcribed into RNA, then RNA is translated into proteins, and these proteins catalyze reactions transforming some of the metabolites that are present outside and inside the cell. So what honor schools do is that they screen thousands of these molecules at a different level of the molecular of the central dogma. And by doing that, we can answer some questions and obtain information about how the cell is behaving at these different levels. For example, using genomics, which is the study of genomes and genes in organisms, we can answer, for example, whether a microbe is capable of performing a process like gene replication just by looking at the gene content. And so, as I said, each of these different knowledge tools are going to give us different information. But the most important part is that by integrating the information pertaining to all these omics tools, we can have a systems level understanding of the functional activity of organisms and how it's changed under environmental conditions. So the next part of my presentation is going to focus on studying the DNA microbiome under microRNA conditions. And as I said, the way that we started this approach was setting up a baby, I mean, that's a reactor. It's kind of a baby, actually. And we set up this reactor, it's a sequencing batch reactor, an SBR, which means that all the different processes that are occurring in the plant, you know, like OGR, anaerobic, and low oxygen concentrations, are occurring in the same container. And then with this reactor operate under cyclic anaerobic, microaerobic conditions, we have the old controls, where we keep the oxygen concentration very low in the system. We don't need a reactor where we have wastewater. We prepare our own version of this wastewater with the same concentration as phosphorus and nitrogen in the nitrates. And this reactor specifically was fed with synthetic wastewater that had acetate as the main organic carbon and ammonia as the energy source. As I said, we actually inoculated the reactor from the local wastewater treatment plant, and we observed that after a couple of months of adaptation, we achieved phosphorus and nitrogen removal condition. And the reason why we say that we achieved phosphorus and nitrogen removal is because we see that the nutrients that we're adding to the reactor are being removed here. And this is a profile of the concentrations of these compounds in the system and how they're changing their reactor over time. So as I said, we have an anaerobic and then a microaerobic concentration, microaerobic stage, and we see here that these different compounds are changing over time. But this is a complicated plot to just analyze at once. So I'm going to decompose it in parts, and you're going to see on the right side what with the leak is going on in terms of the microbial community, the main chemical, biochemical processes occurring here that are explaining what we see in the nutrient profile. For example, during the anaerobic stage, we have acetate consumption and phosphorus release, and that might be due to the presence of these PAOs, polyphosphate accumulating organisms that are doing this process. Then during the beginning of the microbial stage, we start pumping oxygen, although we don't see a high oxygen, the concentration of oxygen increasing here. And it's because these microorganisms are taking all the oxygen that we're pumping into the system, and they're using that oxygen for phosphorus uptake and ammonia oxidation, because we see that phosphorus starts increasing, ammonia is also being oxidized here. However, we don't see any nitrite and nitrate, which are the products of ammonia oxidation, and we hypothesize that the reason why we see this profile is because these PAOs are taking that nitrite and nitrate and use it as electroreceptors for DNA replication. And as you see here, once all the phosphorus is taken by this, taken back by these PAOs, so we remove that variable from the equation, we have now some nitrate accumulation in the system, product from this ammonia oxidizers and nitrioxidizer bacteria. So as a conclusion, under microbial conditions, we see that the microbial community of nitrates turn into a microbiome that's capable of simultaneously removing phosphorus and nitrogen. And this is important because if we could achieve such process at the full scale treatment plant of nitrates, it will bring many benefits. For example, it doesn't only lower the aeration cost, but actually such process will decrease the nitrate concentration in the effluent, and it also will decrease the carbon requirement for denitrification. As I said, nitrate can be harmful from the environment, and some plants have to add extra carbon to get rid of that nitrate. In this case, in one process, we're removing both phosphorus and nitrogen for the system. So it will, this is an extra advantage of this process of the oxygen, macroaerobic DNA. And this also will decrease the slash production. However, although we have demonstrated this process to be possible in our large-scale reactor, other researchers have also demonstrated that such process is possible in other systems. But there are still a lot of knowledge gaps about the main microorganisms, the main functional groups that are actually carrying out these processes. We don't know much about their genomic potential and their genomic constraints. We don't know if the biochemical reactions that we're proposing are actually the ones that are occurring in the system. And more specifically, we don't know which ones are the mechanisms of adaptation of the microbes that are present in DNA processes. And we believe that those mechanisms of adaptation are related to gene expression and regulation. So the next part of my presentation is going to focus on trying to fill some of those gaps and to answer some of these questions. And I'm going to start by talking about this functional group that's quite important. It's called common bacteria. And to introduce you to common bacteria, first we have to talk about our history of the old nitrification. So nitrification is just the oxidation of ammonia to nitrate. So there's a lot of information out there, a lot of research of how these microorganisms can perform nitrification under low oxygen concentration. Here, there are many publications related to this topic. And in the doctoral lab, we have also studied with microorganisms for a while, engineering results about how organisms or which microorganisms can actually perform ammonia oxidation and their specific concentrations of oxygen. Some of these studies have actually figured out that some of the traditional ammonia oxidizing bacteria are also the ones that can carry out this process under low oxygen. But some of these studies have also, although they have been saying that this process is possible, they haven't been able to figure out which microorganism is actually performing the old nitrification. So in order to answer this question, now I can introduce you to Comahos. So until 2 years ago, we thought that ammonia oxidation was a two-step process, where ammonia oxidizing bacteria, archaea, were responsible for ammonia oxidation to nitrite, and then nitrite oxidizing bacteria were taking a nitrite and oxidizing to nitrite. But 2 years ago, two groups in Europe discovered a novel functional group called COMAHOS, which can take ammonia and oxidize it all the way to nitrite. And interestingly, members of this COMAHOS group were classified as Nitrospora, which has been previously assigned to the nitrite oxidizing group. So it's not that all Nitrospora are Comahos, but some Nitrospora can be Comahos and some Nitrospora can be nitrite oxidizers. So after this discovery, we started thinking about all these reactors, but we didn't know which microorganism was doing ammonia oxidation. And we started to wonder if maybe Comahos was present in the system and oxidizing ammonia here, but we weren't aware of that microorganism, we couldn't identify it. So in order to answer this question, we use metagenomic data. So you remember, this is an omics tool that's used for analyzing the genomes and the gene content of microorganisms. And the reason why we use metagenomics is because with conventional tools at that time, we couldn't really identify and quantify Comahos in the systems that we have. And we have also DNA that was saved from the reactors at different stages. So we use this metagenomic analysis, which starts by extracting the DNA of the microbial community. We shear the DNA, we sequence it. These pieces of DNA are assembled into larger quantities using bioinformatics tools, and it's actually a very, a little bit complicated process, but we get to figure it out. And then after assembling these quantities, we can group these quantities into beans, which are basically reconstructions of genomes of the microorganisms that are in the system. So we use this information, we perform that analysis for different sizes of the reactor that we have already saved for all the time that the reactor has been operated already. And we, in order to quantify, to estimate the abundance of these microorganisms in the reactor, we map back the risk, the dynamic risk, to the genomes that we generated, and also other genomes that are available that other people have found before. And we use the number of mapping rates to each of these counties as a proxy for abundance. So what we saw here was very interesting because the reactor in stage one, which is a stage previously to the current operation of the reactor, where we were adding nitrite within the microbial stage to promote the growth of the entire PAOs here. We saw that during that stage, we had an enrichment of comalos and NOBs, the entire splicing bacteria. And then when we switched the operational condition to stage two, we kind of lost those comalos. We also, because the population of NOB also was reduced in the system. And if you see here, we don't see a high number of breaks mapping to any of the known genomes of commonly expressing bacteria or archaea. So we still don't know very well which specific microbe is doing ammonia oxidation in their reactor. But we had data from stage one, from comalos and NOBs, where we were able to assemble genomes from those microorganisms here, from those functional groups. So we decided to use that data, take advantage of the data, and to use it for performing comparative genomics analysis among comalos bacteria. So the first analysis that we did was to take the genome that we recovered from the electrospira in the reactor and compare that to the closest comalos genome that has been published before, which is called Aliandus electrospira nitrosa. And then we looked for specific genes that were abundant in one of these two genes. And we found differences between the two genomes, so I'm just going to highlight two of them. For example, we found that the genome that was previously published of Necrospira nitrosa had a higher gene content of related capsular and extracellular polysaccharide formation. And the reason why we think this is occurring is because the strain that was enriched before was initially found in a biofilm context, while the strain that we have in this reactor has a more planktonic lifestyle. And we also found more genes related to fatty acids in the strain that was enriched in this reactor. And that could give this strain an advantage because fatty acids are present in the wastewater treatment system, so they can potentially use those fatty acids as an extra energy source. We did we took all the genomes that were classified as comalos and all the genomes that were classified as NOBs, and we compared those genomes. And we look for specific traits that might allow us to differentiate the lifestyle of comalos and NOBs. And we found, for example, that while comalos was using to hydrolyze urea and use it as an extra source of ammonia, NOB could degrade cyanide and use that for reciprocal feeding with ammonia oxidizing bacteria. So those two conditions might differentiate the lifestyle of comalos and NOBs, for example. So what did we learn from this analysis? First, in the reactor, comalos and NOBs were enriched when nitrite was supplemented. Once we removed nitrite from the reactor, we completely lost these comalos and these NOBs. The information that we obtained from the analysis allows us for genomic differences between these strains, which give us more information about which adaptation of comalos and NOBs consumers. And this is important to know because we can use this information to predict which conditions are favorable for the growth of one of these two functional groups, and we can use that information when we design novel PLL processes or even like improve the ones that we have already designed. So with that, I want to finish this chapter of my thesis, and I'm going to focus on Micromelibacter. This is my favorite part, so bear with me. I know it's not a lot already, but this is very interesting for me. So why do I care about Acomelibacter? So Acomelibacter phosphatis is a polyphosphate accumulating organism, a PAO, and has a complex metabolism that we engineers harness to remove phosphorus from the system. This metabolism relies on the cycling of different polymers that mycotoxin use to grow and reproduce. For example, during the anaerobic stage, mycotoxin takes the acetate that is present in the system and store it intracellularly as DHA. And the energy that's used for that such process actually comes from the hydrolysis of these polyphosphate molecules, which then which makes accumulated after to pump this phosphate back into the body. Then during the aerobic stage, accumulated now uses that DAH that previously stored and degraded for growth and reproduction. And we also take back that phosphate that released previously to recreate molecules of polyphosphates. And something interesting is that Acomolibacter is also a very diverse bacteria. It has diverged into 14 different clades. And the way that we recognize each of these clades is by using this phylogenetic marker called polyphosphate kinase 1. And the interesting part here is that although like these clades are all Acomolibacter, other research have seen differences in the phenotype of these clades. And specifically, I'm interested on like the difference between these clades in terms of the identifying capabilities. Other research have proposed that some of these clades can perform identification, and some of them can use nitrite, some of them can use nitrate maybe, but there's no agreement, there's no consensus out there where these clades are capable of identification. So our question regarding Acomolibacter, and now that we know that it's actually classified into different clades, was how is the population of Acomolibacter structured in our system? As you remember, we proposed that Acomolibacter could use different electron acceptors, not only oxygen, and we didn't know if those biochemical reactions could be actually linked to the presence of some of these clades. In order to answer this question, I designed several primers to target each of these clades of Acomolibacter and to quantify these clades in their reactor over time. And we quantified it over a period of about 3 years. And interestingly, the population of Acomolibacter switched to a domination to clade 1C, which dominated the Acomolibacter population here in the reactor. So you can see here that clade 1C was the most abundant clade during the last years in the system. So we hypothesized that this clade 1C was the one that could take oxygen and try and nitrate in the system and use it for identification of phosphorus atoms. So in order to test the hypothesis, we decided to carry out an experiment where we added only one electron acceptor at a time into the reactor, and we quantified the phosphorus uptake rate under the presence of each of these electron acceptors. For example, when we only added nitrite after the anaerobic stage, we quantified the phosphorus uptake rate, which is here represented at the black column, we saw that this Acomolibacter, this microorganism was capable of taking some of the nitrite and using it for phosphorus uptake. But then, when we used nitrate, we saw that this phosphorus uptake rate was even higher. So it looks like Acomolibacter would prefer nitrate over nitrite for phosphorus uptake. When we added that oxygen, as we expected, this microorganism to use oxygen for phosphorus for taking the phosphorus in the reactor. And when we added oxygen and nitrate, this phosphorus uptake rate actually increased in comparison to when we had each of these electron acceptors separate. And this is actually, this reactor rate is closer to what we see in a regular cycle. So this result actually indicates that Acomolibacter is performing in oxygen expression, that they use both electron acceptors at the same time. However, what we see here in the reactor is actually the result of the interaction of the microbial community. We can't really say that this, what we're seeing here, is only a product of K1C metabolism. So we needed to look for more information, more evidence to support the hypothesis that we have. And we decided to start from the basics, to study the genomic content, the genome content of the microorganisms that were present here. So similar to what we did with CommonMox, we used metagenomic data to assemble the first draft genome of the clade C. Acomolibacter. And we compared the draft genome that we assembled to other genomes of Acomolibacter that have been previously published. And interestingly, the acromolybacter that's present in this reactor, the acromolybacter, involves a identification pathway to respire nitrate to nitric acid. And this is very important because none of the other acromolybacter genomes that are published out there, none of them have the full identification pathway. So there's a lot of controversy about acromolybacter in the whole process because none of these genomes actually have the whole identification pathway. But the genome, the strain that we have in the reactor, at least genetically speaking, can perform the whole process. And this identification pathway actually involves the presence of different enzymes that are responsible of identifying nitrate here all the way to nitric acid. And these are several enzymes, and each of these enzymes have several units, and all of them are present in the acromolybacter genome that we saw. Furthermore, this genome of acromolybacter clay1c also encodes multiple mechanisms for aerobic respiration. We found at least three different cytochrome C oxidases, which are enzymes involved in aerobic respiration. And each of these cytochrome C oxidases have different capabilities. For example, we have the AN3, which is a low oxygen affinity. It's a cytochrome C oxidase that is usually used when there's high oxygen concentrations in the system. We also found this other CBP3 cytochrome C oxidase, which is high oxygen affinity cytochrome. And interestingly, this cytochrome is found in other microorganisms that can survive microbial and anoxic conditions. Finally, we also found a BA3 cytochrome C oxidase, and there's not a lot of information about this oxidase out there, so I really can't say much about this cytochrome C that is present in the CBP3. So the next step of this analysis involves RNA sequencing. So now we know that the genes are there, but we don't know if they're actually being expressed in acromolybacter. In order to answer this question, I carried out RNA sequencing, which is similar to how we do metagenomics. We extract the RNA of the microbial community, we reverse transcribe the RNA to cDNA, sequence that RNA, and then we use those reads, and we map them to the genome that we previously generated in the metagenomics. And then the number of reads mapping to each of those genomes can be used as a proxy for gene expression. So during the next slide, you're going to see a lot of plots like this one. So I just want to explain what these plots are telling you about the gene expression. So we have gene expression in the y-axis and time in the x-axis. And you can see here the expression of a specific gene. And during the anaerobic and aerobic conditions. And you're always going to see that one of these points is going to have a zero gene expression. It doesn't mean that a acromolybacter is not expressing that gene at that time. It's just that the data is normalized by the minimal expression over the cycle. And we consider a gene to be upregulated if this gene expression increments at values that are higher than one, which is equivalent to twofold increment. So what we did in the case of gene amplification genes is that all these genes, or the majority of these genes, were upregulated during the anaerobic stage and beginning of the microbial stage. Once oxygen starts increasing in the system, these genes the expression of these genes starts decreasing. The only exception here is in ORZ, which is this enzyme here, where we don't see a lot of differences between the gene expression of this enzyme. Then we also look at the gene expression of genes that are involved in aerobic respiration. And we found, for example, that AA3 was actually upregulated during the aerobic process, during the aerobic stage. And CBP3, which is the high oxygen affinity, the one that present in other microorganisms that survive under microbial conditions, was also upregulated during the anaerobic and beginning of the microbial stage. And this pattern is very similar to what we see in the genes that are related to the in terms of the BA3, we don't see also significant changes in the expression of this gene. So it might not be responding to the changes in the oxygen concentration. So this results the upregulation of these genes that are involved in gene amplification and aerobic respiration during the microbial stage indicates that this clay1c is actually using these pathways for simultaneous nitrate and oxygen respiration. And as you saw, there were similar trends in the expression of the interferon-related genes, instead of consuming the three oxidants. And we hypothesized that the reason why they have the same expression patterns is due to transcription regulation. So for the one for you, have how gene regulation works, and this is going to briefly explain how a simplified version of gene regulation itself. So we have the transcription of factors, which are proteins that respond to a signal, which can be in this case, for example, oxygen consumers. That protein is going to bind to the DNA of these microorganisms to a specific site, which is called binding site motif. And then it's going to regulate the expression of the genes that are located downstream in this motif. And if this, and this, the binding of this transcription factor here can actually turn on or turn off the expression of these genes here. And if the genes are all expressed at the same time, they usually call a over. So what's important here is that this transcription factor recognizes this binding site, and this binding site is a conserved region across the DNA. What I mean here is that this transcription factor is going to recognize the same or very similar sequences inside the DNA and start regulating all the genes that are downstream of that sequence. So in the Campylobacter, I learned to get more information about the regulation of these respiratory pathways in the Campylobacter. I looked for some particular regulator that might be contributing to the control of the respiration. And I found that Campylobacter actually involves a lot of these regulators. But there's no information out there about how, if these proteins are actually controlling some of these patterns. There's no information about regulation in that whole part. And but I couldn't figure out if some of these additional patterns were actually important for the pathways that I'm studying here. So what I did was to take the genes that are involved in the identification and are in respiration and start to look for motifs upstream these genes. And interestingly, I found a motif that corresponds to a humoric and arteric adductors binding site. This is an FNR transcriptional factor. And it's present in the majority it's present upstream of the majority of the genes, except for all of them except for humoric. You remember humoric is the one that did not have significant changes in the expression. So FNR is an oxygen responsive transcriptional regulator. And in other microorganisms, it's required for the expression of genes that are involved in respiratory pathways. So it looks like FNR is not only upstream of genes that are involved in identification and aerobic respiration, but also it's located upstream of some genes that are involved in carbon metabolism. What you're seeing here, all the genes that are colored here, they correspond to genes that have the FNR binding site upstream, and the ones that have that color in blue means that they have a positive FNR regulation, which means that they are regulated at the beginning of the anaerobic and microbial stage. We also have in red and negative the genes that have negative FNR regulation, and the green ones are the ones that are present in other genome for Campylobacter, so we don't have functional data. But basically what I want to say here is that all the genes that are colored here have the FNR binding site motif upstream, which indicates that oxygen-driven regulation might not only affect Campylobacter's capability of taking multiple electron acceptors, but actually its ability to metabolize carbon. However, as I said, there's not much information out there about regulation in Campylobacter, so this is just a hypothesis that we generate. Finally, I'm going to show you a different representation of the gene expression data. So you have already seen this plot where you see the expression profiles in terms of time. I'm just going to show you a different representation here, which is based on colors. Blue, each of these colors corresponds to a different gene. And we have a population showing in the yellow and another population in dark blue. And as we expect, we see two different transcriptional patterns of the genes that are regulated by FNR. We have the ones that are positively controlled by this transcriptional factor and the ones that are negatively controlled, and their expression profiles should look something like this. But in reality, that's not what we see. We see actually at least five different different transcriptional patterns of these genes. And what this means is that this difference in transcriptional patterns might indicate what system of other regulatory mechanisms. So FNR is not is probably not the only transcriptional factor involved here, but actually there are other transcriptional factor or genetic factor that are contributing to the expression of this. So finally, we learned from this study that a Cuminbacter glycosi was the most abundant PAO enriched in the microbial conditions in the reactor. And both reactor performance, genome content, and transcriptomic data indicates that glycosi is capable of performing simultaneous aerobic respiration and inactivation. And it looks like regulatory mechanisms might explain the complex metabolism of Cuminbacter, not only in terms of their capability of using multiple receptors, but actually carbon utilization. But as I said, this is a hypothesis and we need to look for more information about it. So finally, I'm just going to talk about the main conclusions and future directions of this research. And so as a conclusion from an engineering perspective, the coupling, by coupling phosphorus cycling reactor, we are creating a transformative development in the operation of PNR processes because, as I said, this can help with aspartame glands reduce PA ratios, the cost of aeration. As Dan mentioned at the beginning, actually, this result inspired the aspartame glands here in Madison to set up and operate a pilot field treatment plant that has been operated by Natalie before and and although we see similar problems occurring in both systems, we also see a lot of difference in the lab scale and the pilot scale reactor. So we still need to look for more information about how these microorganisms can adapt to these conditions in deep, under different compound concentration, temperature, etc. The good thing is that now we have the tools and the workflows to analyze the microorganisms. So we can use for the lab. And the tools that we use, all the work that we generated, and apply them to the lab scale plant. From the scientific side, the results of this research improve our understanding of the influence of microbial conditions in the metabolic shape, in expression, and regulatory mechanisms of these microorganisms. And it's also this study also is a groundwork for deciphering the influence of transcriptional regulation in the PNR system, which is the topic that hasn't been studied with us very well so far. So as a future direction, as I said, we still need to look for more information about transcriptional regulation. And we need to take advantage of the novel methods that are used out there, that are all out there, for understanding not only how one transcriptional regulator works in a Cuminbacter, but actually carry out this analysis as a genome, at a genome scale level. So there are some technologies that are usually used to do such analysis, like ChIP-seq and BACSIC methods. However, the main challenge here is to adapt these methods to a study mixed microorganisms, because so far they have been used for pure cultures, isolated microorganisms. Finally, as I said, we use genomics and transcriptomic data in this study, but there are also other tools available that we can use to improve our understanding of the ecosystem functioning and modeling of these microorganisms in PNR systems. So finally, I just want to acknowledge the people that actually made this research possible. I want to say thank you to my advisors, Mina and Dan. You guys have been amazing advisors. I'm really thankful for all the patience, the understanding, the encouragement to keep working. I'm really grateful for everything, and I'm really happy to cover with you for the last 5 years. I want to say thank you to both the Liberia and my Magnan lab groups. I think this is here are the smartest people I know here in Madison, and I'm so grateful of you having working with them in the last years. They have contributed to this research a lot. They have during our meetings, all their questions, all their feedback was actually what made me finish with our research plans. I also want to specifically say thank you to people in the Wastewater Group, to Chris, Pancho, Natalie, Matt, Evan, Nick, and Evo, and all the other people that were part of this group before that already left. And I also want to say thank you to all the undergrad and high school students that have worked with me over the last years. They actually got me here today, I think. And I'm so happy to have been able not only to work with them, but also to mentor them. I really hope I was a decent mentor, and I hope that they learn a little bit about what's worth treatment and engineering. So now I want to say thank you to the people outside this research, and I'm trying to cry. So I want to start by saying thank you to all my friends. My friends in Chile, and also the friends that I had here in Madison in the last 3 years. I was telling Pancho a couple of days ago how difficult it's going to be living in Madison because I'm going to miss them a lot. We've spent so many great times, like birthday, Christmas, New Year's, Thanksgiving, Halloween together, and actually don't consider them my friends anymore. They are my family. And I really hope that our friendship continues for the next years, whatever we end up pursuing our dreams. So thank you to all of you that have contributed for me to be at this point. I want to say thank you to my family, and I hope they are watching. Especially I want to thank you to my dad, because he was in touch with me so much. He actually wanted to come here and support me for me to come here. And I really hope that my achievement today makes him proud of everything. I know he had to do a lot of sacrifices for me and for my team. So I'm really thankful for those. And I also want to say thank you to my mom. She's, despite the distance, she's always been looking after me and not worry about me. And she told me this morning, I hope she's proud of me. I also want to say thank you to my stepparents. They are great people, and they have always been like taking care of me. And especially, I want to say thank you to my siblings. Yeah, I don't have a very big family, but I do have a lot of siblings. We're all there in the picture. And they are the reason why it was so difficult to come here, and sometimes it was difficult to start from them. But I really hope that what I achieved today actually inspired them to pursue their dreams and to bring beyond borders and to do great things in life and to know that everything is possible. So finally, I just want to say thank you to the most important person in my life, my now husband, Pancho. So we started this journey together, and I'm really happy that you're still with me. You've been my rock and the person that's been next to me all this time, my mom, my cheerleader, and anything you want. And I really appreciate that. I really appreciate you standing with me in the good moments when we have celebrated like all the achievements, but also when everything is very bad and I felt horrible and really overwhelmed and when I leave, you were always very supporting me and for me to stay and to keep pushing, to keep working. And I really need to say thank you for all of that. You're probably the reason why I'm here today, what I could like present to you this very certain to get to this point of my life. He also made me the banana that we tried today, so thank you to for that. But I just want to say thank you to all the people that have contributed to my life, that have made me get me this beautiful moments through the last years and somehow made me like contribute to my happiness here to all these people that I know. Thank you. That has a photo for the camera. I need to say the same as mine so they understand. But thank you, and now just shoot me with questions. I'm ready.
I tried to make sure it started.